we have this dream to make leather without water.
Here we are again for the third episode of our sustainability talk with NNN. So today we have live is the CEO of one of the biggest tannery in the world, Panos.
Yes, first of all, hi to both of you and Nicolo. My name is Panos and I'm the CEO of ECCO Leather, born and raised in the leather business.
How long have you been doing leather in your life?
200 years.
Wow.
My family is 200 years in leather.
What is the oldest piece of leather that you keep?
Some little pieces I had when I was a kid from my father's place, so in the tannery. I was always fascinated with the leather and, yeah, what you could do with that.
Back in Greece?
Yes, back in Greece. In an island, the island of Lesbos. It was a pretty big tannery. Wow. About 500 people, one moment, was working there, so pretty big. A lot of cow leathers, and it was veg tanned, suede, calf.
And how did you get to ECCO?
I studied in Germany, and I studied to leather, and then I was working in a Dutch tannery at that time. I thought maybe some years would be good to get some experience outside Greece, because, you know, maybe Greece is similar to Italy. You get there, you're a bit stuck in the culture to get out of it. It's pretty tough sometimes. So I thought, let's work a bit outside. So I worked in the Netherlands. And then via some coincidence, I was called to talk to this company in Denmark. And that's ECCO. And ECCO at that time did not have really a lot of tanning facility. It was quite small. And then that's how I came 26 years ago.
You look like 18 years old. That's not fair.
You know, it's the cosmetics I use. Being a leather maker is no stress, as you know.
Okay. I don't believe you. I think it's a very, very stressful job, if I remember well.
What is ECCO Leather?
ECCO Leather was created in the year 2000. It's basically a group of tanneries owned from ECCO. ECCO Shoes started really tanning late 80s. Founder Carl Tusby thought, okay, let me make my own leather, and started a small tannery in Portugal at that time. In the year 2000, by then we had a tannery also in Indonesia and a tannery in Thailand. So we thought, let's start a kind of a group that we have a heart about leather, and we start doing more activities than just making leather for our own shoes. And that's ECCO Leather. So ECCO Leather today is consisting of four tanneries in four different locations, three in Asia and one in the Netherlands, which is also the head, let's say, of ECCO Leather.
What kind of tanning you do, and what kind of animal you use in your tannery?
The tanning we do is actually three different lines. It's a chrome tanning, which is, you know, the traditional tanning used by most of the tanneries. We do a synthetic tanning, which we call wet bright. Wet bright gives us the opportunity to do incredible vibrant colors. Prism tanning. A prism gives you the most reliable colors. And then we have a veg, but a new modern way of veg, maybe not the very traditional. 30% on veal and calf. 30% is Dutch, German, and North European cows. The rest is US steers. We have also as a specialty yak, from Tibet and Mongolia. It's something we're stuck with it because we simply love it.
Give us some numbers.
We process about 2.4 million hides a year, 90 million square feet.
Big tannery like this does a lot of things in sustainability. It's not advertising for ECCO Leather. What is sustainability?
Sustainability is, first of all, a word which evolved with the years. It's a way of life. We do not speak too much about it because it's something which we live with it. So something we always believed in it. Sustainability started many, many years ago with very more simple ways like treat your water, have clean water. Of course, it evolved with the years, use less energy, less water. Today, we discuss even more about recycling, upcycling. So basically, we see it in three different phases. It's the phase before the skin arrives to the factory, from the farm to the slaughterhouse, the phase in the tannery where it becomes a leather, and now the life after, what will happen after. And for us, it's important that we capture all three. The first one, mostly with the form of a traceability to know where the skins are from and how much possible you can trace it back to the farm. not per se because we love to know the farm, but also to know how the animal is treated and what is it. And then, of course, we have the phase which is in our own factories. And there we talk about, there used to be a sustainability of, as I said, treat the water well, and then you're a good tannery. It's a little bit different today because it's not just treat the water, that's a way of life. But also in the past, you used to put all the dirt, let's say, from coming out of the heights in the water, and then you treat them. Today we try to see, can we take away before it reaches the water? Meaning, can we recycle the hair of the skin? Can we take fat out and use it for biodiesel, use it for even actually to even use it again in the process to make the hide softer. So a total recycling. Can we use less water? So we think sustainability is first, of course, use as less as possible water in the process, generate much less solid waste. And then finally, how much energy you use to manufacture that leather. Where is the energy coming from? Is it renewable? In ECCO, we don't talk about renewable by buying certificates to be renewable or buying renewables, but creating energy and creating energy with real, true, like via biogas. We do that out of the waste, fleshings of the hides, plus also with renewable energy out of the sun. Additional to that is what do we put in the hide? This is a new element, which I think the industry has to work with more. Where are the chemicals we put in coming from? Is it from natural base? Is it from mineral oils? Why not use only natural oils? For instance, we do a lot of oiled waterproof leathers and we change everything now to natural oils, not mineral based oils. So an additional element is what do you put in the skin? And then finally, this will allow us to do way more for the afterlife. The new synthetic tannage, including the new veg tannage, is actually biocompostable or also biodegradable, and that's what we're working on. The moment the consumer decides to give an end of a life of the product and go back to earth.
Foam-free or metal-free leather is really the answer to the pollution that we are producing in a tannery or not?
Chrome has been heavily misunderstood. Chrome has, you know, the 3 equivalent and the 6 equivalent. The chrome 6 is a poison. Chrome 6 maybe has been used by somewhere in the world, but I think it's almost not used anywhere anymore. Chrome 3 is, by the way, a metal which comes from Mother Earth, mostly South Africa, I would say. And actually, for the wastewater treatment, the easiest chemical to take back because it's a metal. A metal you can claim from the water very easily, giving a very solid, good quality leather. So probably the best solid leather. If we talk about biodegradability and so, this is where it becomes a bit more tricky because it's so well done that it can last forever. You could also argue last forever is also a sustainable solution because a product which lasts very long is sustainable, right? The most important view is that make all three tannages better continuously. Improve the chrome tannage, improve the synthetic tannage, and improve the veg tannage. So I would say definite, it's not a bad thing to have a chrome tannage.
And what about the dry tan?
It's a dream to make leather without water. The dream is not just to save water per se because we need just the water to drink. Because we have to be realistic, it depends where you are. We are in the Netherlands and it's raining 300 days a year. So there's probably a lot of water here. In other places of Earth, there is very little water. But we should also know that when we use water, we have to treat the water. To treat the water, you need chemicals and energy. And that's where the sustainable thing comes. Dry tan is basically eliminating the water from a part of the process, which is purely the tanning process. We turn the leather to the skin to a sponge, so it pulls all the chemicals in. You have 100% absorption of chemicals. Basically, you have no chemical waste. So dry tan is the first step. The version 2 is already operational, which is moving to dry retanning, meaning the retanning process, now we're eliminating water there too. Our research team is working also on the dry tan 3, 4, and 5. Ultimately, the 5 is the taking from tanning to finished leather without any water at all in a total new technology under total different circumstances. which will make leather way more energy sufficient and actually will reduce dramatically the time. In our facility just in the Netherlands, we eliminate 25 million liters of water a year, about 12%.
Companies are trying to offset their energy use with a solar panel or other instrument. Do you think that there will be the possibility tomorrow to be energy neutral or energy positive?
Or water positive?
We're using an organic material, which is the skin. Means that there is a lot of caloric value, very high caloric value. So we need to use the caloric value of the skin and create energy out of it, that's in the form of biogas or many other methods. I believe that the future is that tannery should be definitely neutral, and if not, like we say, generating extra energy. And I think it's possible, yes. We've seen, for instance, our facilities in the Netherlands is energy neutral already now with the biogas and all this. In China, our factories by far almost energy neutral. So a lot of things could be done.
And salt is one of the biggest polluting chemicals. How do you approach this?
In the Netherlands, we don't use salt because all the hides we source around. We also believe that when you buy a hide, for instance, from the United States, don't buy the hide, buy it tanned already, because why should we transport raw hides? Why not tan immediately next to the slaughterhouse? The facilities are there. So that's what we believe. Salt is not a big issue for us.
A lot of people don't want to buy leather products because they think that you kill the animal for the leather. How do you make sure that cow Lola is treated in the right way in that farm?
First of all, I think it's very good, and it's a very good evolution that someone wants to be vegan and wants to eat animal free. I think it's very good. And I like that this is recognized also commercially. Our duty as leather makers is to make leather the best possible, sustainable, ethical way. As long as there will be farming, cows, and people eat meat and drink milk out of a cow, probably there will be a skin. This skin has to be, something has to be done. And there may be many different ways to do something like that. But actually the most sustainable way, you could say it's upcycling, is to make leather. A tannery should be responsible to source the material and know way more where the cow is raised. And I can't say every day what happened to that cow, but we know farms which are really treating animals well. So animal well-being should be a very important thing. How animals are slaughtered should be done the right way. Veganism is a good trend, and I think the world has more than 7 billion people, and a percentage of these will believe in this, and I think it's right. Where I would say my view, and this is also my personal view in that, is that we need to be fair and honest, transparent in all areas.
Is your CR engaged directly with the shoe company, or you guys have two different CSR
and reports to the CSR? One, and sustainability is also one, because it's a culture in ECCO.
Thinking about the material and the sustainability and what will be the sustainability in the future, what will be the material of the future? Isotech is experimenting mushroom, so Adidas is planning to use for next year. How much is true, we don't know yet. Can this be really a sustainable replacement? Maybe not to leather, but to the other kind of PU?
I think it's a definite, a very good direction that the world is working actively to find a new organic-based material. Now, if mushroom is the total solution, we have our own experience already actually 6 years ago when things were starting. Still today, we're actually working with the university in Milan. There is a very good advanced science in the mushroom field. I'm a believer of that, but it needs to be done the right way. I don't think it's a leather, because it's not leather. It doesn't need to be also called leather, actually cannot. What I don't believe is just we take something, we press it together, we apply PU and we call it leather. That's not. And maybe there are some quick gains around the world, around people claiming that. I saw also other leathers, which we tested also from various other materials. Macelium does not have the long fibers of leather and therefore not the strength. We also have to see what does it take to grow Macelium. Macelium is not a green plant, so Macelium actually gives CO2, does not take CO2.
It needs a lot of water and a lot of power to grow.
We work on this and we work together to find also something. So I encourage that very much as we have a responsibility to be sustainable, we also have a responsibility to deliver a product which is at the price which is affordable.
During your hot shop with all the designers coming from all around the world, do you speak about sustainability and how do you approach it?
We had 13 hot shops. I think the first 5-6 ones, we did not really speak at all about sustainability. Maybe it wasn't a big subject or we didn't know how to talk about it. We talk more and more. We want with the designers, it's not just let's make another kind of leather. It's actually more to see their views and have this common energy of 150 people together from so many different backgrounds and then say, how do you see leather in the future? Not per se, it will be a black color or a brown color or a red color. That's irrelevant. But what is the leather? What is the functionality of the leather? And sustainability plays a very, very big role. Leather can be used in way more materials on a very sustainable way, and which is not today.
You do a lot of creation from the hot shop, students coming in the company to research new artists working there. Where do you get all this inspiration?
First of all, you need to have a belief. First of all, you need to have a real belief in something, to have a vision in something. My belief is that leather can also be done by people who don't know leather. So you need to be open to this.
That's a very beautiful belief.
Traditionally, sometimes we feel that we have to be super closed. I believe we have to be pretty open. Secondly, I believe in this energy of connecting many people together and commercial energy. The hot shop has nothing to do with commerciality or the actual effect of selling. Actually get these people together, get this energy and get ideas. The ideas, of course, to do that is coming from many other things. I myself have been in Burning Man. I learned a lot of the Burning Man philosophy, getting people together. I've seen it, I lived it. I think it inspired me very much. And I believe in maybe, for some people it's maybe a naive, I believe in this world where commerciality is the last step. The creation is something else. And this is what drives it. There is a lot of art. I happen to be married to an artist, which inspires me also very much. And daily life, it's open-mindedness. But I think very much it's important to have a philosophy and a vision about it.
Thanks a lot, Panos. I think this conversation was very helpful for everyone and enlightening for the most of us. Thank you so much for sharing your experience and your life and your knowledge.
Thank you very much, guys. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure. Knowing both of you is a pleasure.